I am counting every blessing, counting every blessing, letting go and trusting when I cannot see. I am counting every blessing, show me every season, you are good to me. I am counting every blessing, letting go and trusting when I cannot see. I am counting every blessing, surely every season, you are good to me.
Good morning. Aren't you glad you're here today? Everybody wake up. All right. Awesome. Praise God. God, 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 God. It is good to be with you this morning. It's always an honor to be able to be here up here like this and to get to preach for Pastor Craig when he is away. And I will say it's much less distracting when he's actually away and not sitting on the front pew looking at me like he was last time we did this. So anyway, go ahead and grab your Bibles if you would. You know what to do. Open to Ephesians. Ephesians chapter 6. Now, we've been going through the book of Ephesians now for 7 months. And yet we still have just barely scratched the surface of the depths of the riches that God has given us in this book. In fact, multiple times Craig and I talked about his sermons, and he would say that he would look back on his notes on Ephesians from past times that he's been through this and how God is just showing him so much more this time through. And so hopefully God has changed and challenged our lives as we have been through this in the past 7 months, but that doesn't come to an end today. That all that God has shown us, all that God has taught us, all that he's put in our hearts, we must continue to apply to our lives as we seek to live our lives for the glory of our King. And so as we come this morning to chapter 6, verses 19 through 24, I want to pause and kind of look back to where we've been. I think if you look back over all that we've seen in Ephesians, you would say with me that this book, more than any other book in the Bible, really presents to us the resources and the power and the blessings that are ours as a believer in Jesus Christ. It's kind of incomparable in that sense, which is why Craig called this whole series Counting Every Blessing. What Peter says in 1 Peter 1:3 in just one phrase, he says that we have been given everything we need for life and godliness is kind of magnified and expanded on in the book of Ephesians. And so it began all the way back in chapter 1, verse 3, where Paul wrote and he says that God has blessed you in the heavenly realms with every spiritual blessing in Christ. And then for 6 chapters, he explains and unpacks what those blessings truly are. So I want to kind of remind us of what we've seen. You can't turn to all these things, but there are some handouts on the side you can pick up as we go. But in terms of counting every blessing, just listen to what we've seen so far. According to chapter 1, verse 3, we are super blessed. Verses 4 to 6, we are super loved. Verse 7, we are forgiven and redeemed. Verse 8, we have been given wisdom. Verse 11 says we are made rich. Verse 13 says we are secure and sealed with the Spirit of God. Chapter 2, verses 4 to 6 says we are alive with new life. Verse 7 says we are the objects of eternal grace. Verse 10, that we are God's masterpiece. Again, verse 10, that we are called to a life of good works that God will do through us. Verses 13 through 18, that we are one with God and with all believers. That verse 19, we are members of God's intimate family. Verse 22, that we are the habitation of the Holy Spirit. Chapter 3, verse 20 says that we are powerful beyond our own imagination. Verse 21 says that we are able to actually glorify God. Now, what an incredible description of a human being. To put all that together, that's who we are in Christ, what we can do in Christ. It's an amazing what God has done for us beyond anything we could imagine there. But as you move into chapter 4, it just keeps going. Chapter 4, verse 3 says, we are told we possess the living Spirit of God in us. Verses 4 to 6, that we are members of the body of Christ. Verses 11 to 13, that we've received gifts and gifted men to perfect us to do the works of ministry. Verse 20 through 24, that we have Jesus Christ to teach us to walk in new life. In chapter 5, verses 1 and 2, we've received the love of God so that we can walk in love. Verse 8, we've received God's very light that we might dwell in light. Verses 15 to 17, we've received the wisdom and the truth of God so that we can walk wisely in the world. Verse 18, we've received the power of the fullness of the Spirit of God. Verse 21 through chapter 6, verse 9, we've received the resources to make all of our relationships all that God intends them to be. Finally, in chapter 6, verses 10 through 17, we have received the invincible, powerful armor against which the enemy of God is helpless if we will use it. And it climaxes in the magnificent sword of the Spirit, which is the very word of God he has placed in the hand of every believer. And as incredible as all of that is, what we saw last week is that there's a final step in Paul's letter. That yes, we have all that. Yes, that has been given to us in Christ by God. And yet its effectiveness in our lives, our experience of it, still depends on God. And so lastly, in chapter 6, verse 18, we saw last week that we have received access to the guidance and the grace of a relationship with God himself through prayer. That's amazing there. I read one pastor kind of likened it to a story about Tom Landry as the coach of the Cowboys, that when you get to be a professional football player and you're that level in your career that you know the game, you know your position, you know football, you have the skills, the training, the experience, you have the talent, the wisdom and know-how, you know your position, you know your game. And yet that hulking young man with all of those skills who's mastered his domain, so to speak, still has to depend upon this little dude on the sideline with a clipboard telling him what to do at every single moment. Here's the actual legend part, that if there was a game when the Cowboys lost, I know, God forbid, sorry I said that, but if the Cowboys actually lose, what Coach Landry might have said when he walked into their locker room was this. Coach walks in and says, "Gentlemen, I told you how to win the game. You didn't do what I told you, so you lost." And then he'd turn and walk out. Now, I have no idea if that is true, but it makes the point very well there that we can have all the resources and all the blessings that we can imagine, and if we don't do life the way that God tells us to do, we will still lose. And that's why Paul ends this letter of Ephesians that began in chapter 1 in the very heavenlies on its knees in chapter 6, because we are dependent upon prayer to access what God has given us in the heavenlies. So that's where we ended last week with Pastor Craig. And so now we come to these last few verses where you think there's not much left to say. And Paul closes with a very specific illustration. If you'll look with me in Ephesians 6, beginning in verse 19. He says, "Pray also for me that whenever I speak, words may be given me so that I will boldly make known the mystery of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador in chains. Pray that I may declare it boldly as I should. Tychicus, the dear brother and faithful servant in the Lord, will tell you everything, so that you may also know how I am and what I am doing. I'm sending him to you for that very purpose, that you may know how we are and that he may encourage you. Peace to the brothers and love with faith from God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Grace to all who love our Lord Jesus Christ with an undying love." Now, if you'll indulge me for a moment today, I want to take this kind of as a whole real quickly before we come back and dig a little deeper. So Paul ended in verse 18 saying, "Keep on praying for all of God's people," right? And then he says, "I'm the illustration." You want to pray for somebody, he says, "Pray for me, not for my physical needs, but for the battle that I am in. Pray that God will allow me to be bold and courageous and that he would give me words." Because Paul now is a prisoner in Rome. He says, "I'm an ambassador in chains," is what he says. So the battle was tough. He admits his need. He admits his struggle. And he says, "Please pray for me." Now, if I can just kind of pause here and kind of ride his coattails when he says that and just submit something into your minds today. Pray for your pastor. Pray for your preacher. I'll come back to this, but as God walks us through everything he's going to unpack today about Paul and what's happening in this text, I want you to keep that reality in the back of your mind, that you, that me, that all of us, we need to be praying for our pastor. And Paul tells us how to do that. He gives us the example. He asked them to pray for the spiritual battle to be won, that he would not lose his courage or his boldness. And then back in 21 and 22, he explains that in order for them, the Ephesians, to know about his condition, his needs, his situation, he's sending this guy Ty to go see him with this letter. So this guy Ty is a friend of Paul. He's mentioned five times in the New Testament, and he's the one who's actually going to take the actual handwritten letter from Paul to the church at Ephesus because they are worried about Paul. They care about Paul. They don't know what's going on. They know he's in prison. They've not heard anything. They're concerned. And so Paul says, I'm going to send Ty to you so that you can know and pray intelligently. He'll tell you how I'm doing. He'll tell you where the battle lies, and you can pray. And then from there, Paul offers a benediction that I'm not going to be able to go into today. But I do want us to go back to verse 19 and not miss this. Because it's really easy for us to when we take the Bible apart over a long period of time, as we've been doing for the past 7 months, it's easy for us to kind of forget or miss or lose sight of the context and the history and the writer and how all of that impacts what God wants to say through what he's written in his word. And so if you allow me today, what I want to do is kind of do a deep dive on Paul at this moment. What that begins with is right here, that here is Paul towards the end of his Christian journey, and he is very aware of his need for the prayers of the people who love him and support him. This is the Apostle Paul, and yes, he's in prison, but he's kind of towards the end of his Christian journey, and he is very aware of his need for the prayers of those who love him and who support him. And I think it's really key for us to see that the effectiveness of Paul's ministry and the influence of his pen and the number of people that he got to speak the mystery of the gospel to, and kings and princes and rulers and all kinds of people, some of whom were ushered into the kingdom of God, that all of that has not led Paul to a place where he thinks he's reached some kind of plateau. And in his own mind, he's thinking, you know, I think I've pretty much got this down. I got a handle on this. I can do this. I got the ability. I got the gifts. I got the experience. I can handle this. No, that's not at all what Paul is thinking. What he says is, you guys need to be praying all the time for all God's people with all kinds of prayers and all kinds of endurance. And he says, and you must be praying for me as well. You know, when Craig first gave me these verses that he wanted me to cover today, and I read through them, the first thing was, gee, thanks for these, Craig. Then I read a second time, I went through them, and the first thing that I put down in my notes was the word superhero. Then I put a line through it. Because I know that we often think of Paul as the super apostle, as the mighty apostle. And if you just do kind of a surface study and reading of Paul's life and experiences from the book of Acts and through his letters, you might think that there's some superhuman ability going on in Paul's life there. But I want you to get this in your notes this morning, that Paul was not a superhero. Paul was not a superhero. In fact, out of his own mouth, if he was going to say that he was super anything, he'd say that he was a super sinner. What do you tell Timothy back in 1 Timothy when he said that Christ has come into the world to save sinners, of whom I am the worst? Even here in Ephesians 3, I think verse 8, he says that I am the least of all of God's people. Which ought to encourage us, because we know that in Romans 12, Paul tells them, and he says, don't think of yourself more highly than you ought, but with sober judgment according to the faith that God has given you. And so we see that Paul is doing himself what he's telling us to do. And so it's one thing for him to tell us in Ephesians 6 that you people need to be praying. But it's a whole other channel for him to say, and I desperately need you to be praying for me. And so I want to kind of camp out here this morning on this, and I want to start with those few words, pray for me also. And there are two things I want to suggest that we identify this morning. And the first one is this, take note of Paul's vulnerability. Take note of Paul's vulnerability. That Paul hasn't written to them, for example, back in verse 10 and said, you don't wrestle with flesh and blood, but with all of these dark powers. He said, we don't wrestle with the flesh and blood, but with all of these dark powers. In many ways, Paul was at the front of the parade, the tip of the spear, so to speak. He was very aware of the enemy and the attacks and the schemes of the enemy. And so when he writes to Timothy, for example, to kind of warn Timothy of some of the things that he might encounter as a young pastor, he's doing so out of his own experience. And one of the things that we see in Paul's experience that is important to his vulnerability is that he was vulnerable to the pain of desertion. Paul himself was vulnerable to desertion. He refers to that in 2 Timothy chapter 1 when he writes this. He says, "You know that everyone in the province of Asia has deserted me." Now, even if we leave room for hyperbole there, that's still a whole lot of people who Paul loved, who Paul depended upon, who Paul thought were a part of his group that have bailed on him and deserted him, and he has experienced the pain of that. Now, if you're a leader, if you're a pastor, that's not what you want. You want numbers to increase. You don't want them to decrease. And so when Paul writes to Timothy in 2 Timothy 4:3, he says, "For the time will come when people will not put up with sound doctrine. Instead, to suit their own desires, they will gather around them a great number of teachers to say what their itching ears want to hear. They will turn their ears away from the truth, and in doing so, away from you." He writes to say, Timothy, you need to know that this can happen, and I can tell you this can happen because it has happened to me. He's not writing Timothy out of some kind of spandex-covered superhero, unvarnished victory that he doesn't know what it's like. He's saying that I have been vulnerable to desertion. I know what it feels like. I think he's also, number two here, I think he's vulnerable to pride. Paul is vulnerable to pride. That truth was made obvious to him multiple times throughout his ministry, but never more obviously than we saw in 2 Corinthians chapter 12. Remember there when he asked the Lord three times to remove from him what he called a thorn in the flesh? Remember what he said about that? How did he describe that? That it was given to him to keep him from becoming conceited. Now, why would Paul say that? Why would Paul confess that he had that to keep him from becoming conceited? Because Paul was vulnerable to becoming conceited. He was vulnerable to pride. And if we think about Paul's life before he became a believer in Jesus Christ and realize the family that he grew up in and the education that he attained and did so well in and the status that he had achieved in the community that was of that day, then it's easy for us to see how in his journey it would be easy for Paul to kind of revert mentally to that type of view of himself. And God knew that. And so God loved Paul enough that to keep Paul from becoming useless because he became a fathead, Paul says, "It was given to me a thorn in the flesh to keep me from becoming conceited." So Paul says, "Pray for me also." I think he was vulnerable to desertion. He was vulnerable to pride. And lastly, I think he was vulnerable to depression. And maybe you're thinking I'm exaggerating that, but let me just kind of explain to you or read to you what he said himself. In 2 Corinthians chapter 1, listen to verse 8. He says, "We do not want you to be uninformed, brothers, about the troubles we experienced in the province of Asia. We were under great pressure, far beyond our ability to endure, so that we despaired of life itself. Indeed, we felt we had received the sentence of death." See what he's saying there? I mean, look at that. He says, "We were completely overwhelmed. The burden seemed more than we could possibly bear. In fact, we said to ourselves, this is it. This is the end of the road." And yet Paul continues in that letter and he writes how they believed that they had that experience of coming to the end of themselves, that they might learn to trust in God and not in themselves. But he says in verse 11, "As you help us by your prayers, then many will give thanks on our behalf for the gracious favor granted us in answer to the prayers of many." So if Paul's not a superhero, he's not there at Corinth saying, "I know this is scary. I know you guys feel the weight. You guys take a break, a breather, get some lemonade. I got this. I can handle it. I got the gifts. I got the experience. I got the power. I'll deal with this." That's not what he says at all. He says it's through the prayers of many that many will give thanks for what God does in us. So as you read Paul saying in Ephesians, "And pray for me also," I think that there's definitely a vulnerability that is exposed in that prayer request from Paul. It's important for us to kind of look at there, but we also need to see something else. Secondly, there is a humility there. Take note of Paul's humility. And I really believe there's a direct correlation between vulnerability and humility. And the reason is this, is that when we are confident in ourselves, then we don't really need to pray or ask anybody else to pray for us. It is humility. is in our awareness of our need, of our desperate need. It is in our awareness of the enemy who is in opposition to us. When that becomes real to us, that's what then moves us to our knees in prayer and to ask others to pray for us. And so what we see here in Paul, beyond his vulnerability in Ephesians 6, is something really beautiful, because what we see here is a humility that flows out of his awareness of his very deep need. That Paul is aware of his need, and it shows up in his humility, and we see that in what he asks them next. He doesn't just say, and pray for me too. He tells them specifically how he wants them, longs for them to pray for him. And he doesn't say what we might say. And I can't speak for you, but if it were me in Paul's shoes and I'm asking this church to pray for me, I'm saying, pray that I will get out of here. Pray that I can get out of this jail cell, out of this prison, out of these cuffs, away from this Roman soldier. Pray that I can get a decent meal and a shower, for God's sake, and some clean clothes. That's what I'm asking. Pray for that. That's not what he does at all. He doesn't pray for his freedom like that. I read one pastor who put it like this. He said that Paul does not pray for liberation. He prays for effectiveness and proclamation. See, Paul, even now, is focused not on himself, but on the ministry of the gospel. What we see him asking for in this prayer request is not for himself, but the ministry of the gospel. Please get this, that he wants, in the context in which he finds himself, he wants to be about people being delivered from the dominion of the devil. He wants to be about transformation still taking place in the hearts of those around him. So in that context, if you really kind of look here in Ephesians 6 at that request, look at what he actually says. When he says pray, he says, pray that whenever I speak, words may be given me so that I will fearlessly or boldly make known the mystery of the gospel. Now, the King James Version of the Bible uses a different word there. And it's an old word, but I think it's a very good word, because what the King James says is, pray that utterance may be given me. I think that's helpful for us to see this in this, because we're trying to see about humility and his awareness of his need and his desperation here, because he isn't simply asking for words. I need words to be given me. Paul didn't need words. Paul was an expert in words. So Paul's not asking for an increase in his vocabulary. Paul is asking for utterance. Paul's not asking for an increase in vocabulary. He knew the words. He's asking for utterance. He's asking for the word to be given to him. Utterance is the difference between saying something and having something to say. But even more, utterance, if you go back to Acts chapter 2 at Pentecost, and Luke is describing what happened at Pentecost in the coming of the Holy Spirit, and what he says is that utterance was given them and they spoke in languages that they did not know. So what we're seeing there is that utterance is an expression of the direct work of the Holy Spirit of God. Utterance is an expression for the direct work, the direct action of the Holy Spirit of God. And that's what Paul is saying that he needs. That's what he's asking them to pray for. Maybe I can explain it. If you want to, turn with me to 1 Corinthians chapter 2. I mean, kind of get a picture of this without using the word. In 1 Corinthians chapter 2, Paul says in verse 1, he says, when I came to you, I did not come with eloquence or human wisdom as I proclaimed to you the testimony about God. He says, I came to you in weakness, with great fear and much trembling. My message and my preaching were not with wise and persuasive words, but with a demonstration of the Spirit's power, so that your faith might not rest on human wisdom, but on God's power. That's what Paul is asking for. That's what he's longing for. He's saying, I want you to pray for me so that when words are given me and my mouth is open to proclaim this truth, that it might have this kind of impact. And why does Paul need that? Think about where Paul is. Who's he going to talk to? He doesn't have much of a congregation at this point in his life while he's in prison, but that's the point. That doesn't matter to Paul. He's asking this church in Ephesus to pray for him that he might have this so that whoever he comes in contact with, be it another prisoner, a different Roman soldier, a random visitor into the jail, whatever it be, that that person might come into contact by the power of the Holy Spirit at work with the gospel of Jesus Christ. And so to that end, he asks for one other thing. He asks for utterance. And then he asks for boldness. Your version may say fearless, the same word. In verse 19, he says that he might have boldness. In verse 20, that he might speak with boldness. Two things about that real quick. First of all, this is not about performance. It's not about personality traits. This isn't what Paul's asking for in boldness. We just saw in 1 Corinthians 2 how he said that he came there with weakness and fear and much trembling, and that didn't bother Paul. He was okay with that. So it's not about performance or presentation or a personality trait. And secondly, it's not what you and I probably think of when we think of boldness. Remember how utterance meant more than just words. There was more to that. There's more to boldness as well. And the best way that I can kind of unpack that for you is if all of us go real quickly back to Acts chapter 4. Go ahead and turn your Bibles to Acts 4. As you turn there, just think about in Acts chapter 3, what's going on there is Peter and John were headed to the temple, and they have to go through a gate. And there's a gate there, and there's a lame man begging at that gate heading into the temple. And Peter sees him, and Peter says this. He says, "Silver or gold I do not have, but what I do have I give to you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, get up and walk." And the dude gets up and walks. And that just threw all of the religious leaders of that day into an uproar. And so basically they take Peter and John into a kind of custody because they don't like what's going on and they want it to stop. And so now we come to Acts chapter 4 and Peter and John are in custody and they are in front of the entire Jewish Sanhedrin. And look at what Peter says in verse 10. He says, "Know this, you and all the people of Israel. It is by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, but whom God raised from the dead, that this man stands before you healed. Jesus is the stone you builders rejected, which has become the cornerstone. Salvation is found in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given to mankind by which we must be saved." And then Luke, writing this in Acts, immediately describes this. He says, "When they saw the boldness of Peter and John and realized they were unschooled, ordinary men, they were astonished and took note that these men had been with Jesus." In other words, it wasn't like they saw this and heard Peter saying this. And they went, "Well, this makes sense. Look at these guys. Look at their education. Look at their experience. Look at their status in community. Look at the level of life that they are living. This makes perfect." No, it didn't make perfect sense. What caught their eye was the boldness of Peter and John. And what was the basis of that boldness? Look at it. It was the proclamation of Jesus. Unashamedly, this is who Jesus is, that he is the crucified Lord, the risen King, the ascended one. It was on account of that boldness, and they're seeing that boldness, that they were released and able to proceed. But it doesn't stop there. If you keep reading here in Acts chapter 4, Peter and John go back to kind of the community of believers that they had come out of, who were praying for them and afraid for them. And when they get back there, they rejoice over all that happened, and they begin to pray. And what do they pray? Look at Acts 4:29. It says, "Now, Lord, consider their threats and enable your servants to speak your word with great boldness." They didn't pray, "Okay, God, this is great. Thanks for this. This is answered prayer. You got Peter and John out of a jam. They're back free with us. Help us get them out of the city where they're not in trouble, where they can be safe, where they can have comfort. Give them peace of mind." No, they didn't pray for comfort or for safety or for peace of mind. They prayed for boldness. And look at verse 31, says, "After they prayed, the place where they were meeting was shaken. And they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and spoke the word of God boldly." You see, in the face of external pressure, and even with internal opposition, even in the church, boldness is necessary. And it doesn't mean speaking in unkindness. Paul already covered that back in Ephesians 4 when he says you got to speak with love, speak the truth with love. So what this boldness is an impact that is tied directly to the proclamation being spoken. It is tied to the proclamation of Jesus. Hear that again. Boldness is an impact that is tied to the proclamation of Jesus. It's tied to the gospel itself. And folks, that is what Paul is asking the church at Ephesus to pray for. Pray that I would have utterance, that the Holy Spirit of God would move when I speak, and pray that when it happens that I would have boldness, that the impact of the proclamation of Jesus would settle on men's hearts in a way that cannot be explained. Utterance and boldness is what Paul is praying for. One of the reasons the church of today has such an ambiguous voice in our culture and seems like it's ready to vacillate on so many different issues or statements or truths. In other words, one of the reasons why the church of today is missing this utterance and is missing this boldness is because of a loss of conviction about the gospel of Jesus Christ. I mean, why would anyone speak to the world or to their neighbor or their coworker that there is one mediator between God and man, and it is the man Jesus Christ? That Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life, and no man comes to the Father but by him. That there is no other name under heaven given to us by which man must be saved, unless that is the conviction of their heart. That whether it's under attack or not, it does not change. They have based their life on that conviction. Why would anybody speak to their Jewish friends and say, when you read the law of Moses, there is a veil over your heart that can only be taken off in the person of Jesus Christ, unless they know that and they base their life on the reality and the conviction of Jesus Christ, no matter what anyone else says? You know, as I studied for this morning, I read lots of people who said different things, and one of the guys who I read about or from was Alistair Begg. Alistair Begg is a preacher from Scotland who is a pastor in Cleveland, which that's got to be the worst assignment ever. If you're in Scotland and God says go to Cleveland, that's like, I don't know what that's like, but that's not good. Anyway, he talked about an article in the Daily Telegraph that I just couldn't get past, and this is the heading of that article. Listen to this. That Western Christianity is not dying out from natural causes. It is dying of suicide. It's written by a guy who's actually a Roman Catholic, but it comes from a pretty objective perspective. And I think it's worth us considering his thesis this morning. Some of this I'll put on the screen for you as we go through this, beginning with this. What he says in the article is this, that the church has now for decades been chasing after cultural acceptance by trying somehow or another to offer itself to a world that is disinterested in it in such a way that it will excite them. Just let that settle for a second. He gives examples of a church in San Francisco where the church leaders and the pastors apparently dress up in costumes and kind of come dancing down the aisles in order to be some kind of novel attraction to draw in guests. Can you imagine Pastor Larry in a clown suit coming down the aisle? That's not going to work. He gives another example, though, of a discussion in a newspaper down over there between a pastor and the editor about whether God has a gender. And this pastor actually said, I don't want young girls or young boys to hear us constantly referring to God as he, because that might alienate people. And the author actually says to that pastor, don't worry about it because no one's listening to you. But he writes that we blame our failing numbers on everything but ourselves. That the truth is that Western Christianity is not dying out from natural causes. It is committing suicide. And he articulates the fact that when the church of Jesus Christ ceases to pray, as Paul prays here in Ephesians 6, that we might have utterance, that we might have the direct work of the Holy Spirit, that we might have boldness, that God might act on the proclamation of Jesus Christ, that when the church ceases to pray to do that, it actually deserves to fizzle out and die. One more quote from this. The article says, these people, these religious leaders in Western Christianity, that's us, really are interested in seeing the church prosper, but they are smothering it. They have transformed a faith that only extended as far as it did through preaching and martyrdom into something anxious and introspective, excessively concerned with gender pronouns and saving the redwood tree and themselves. Make no mistake, this is not a debate about left and right in church politics. No, it's about whether the church talks chiefly about man or about God. It's about whether Christians have a distinct message at all. Church, that article was written 3 years ago. Think about all that's happened in the past 3 years. How much more today is this not a clarion call to you and me? See, this is why. It is so vitally important that in every generation we learn again to pray like the Apostle Paul in Ephesians 6. This is why it's so crucial, not just for the people on stage, but for all of us to learn to pray like Paul is asking his church to pray in Ephesians 6. So I'm just going to wrap this up. I'm just going to give you some questions today to take home and process. These are in your notes. Is there a vulnerability in our lives? What I mean, is there a freedom from us trying to prove anything to anyone else or to protect anything from anyone else? Is there a vulnerability in us? Secondly, is there a humility flowing out of that vulnerability where we know our need, where we are very aware of our complete dependence on Jesus Christ for anything and everything in this life? Is there a vulnerability and is there a humility in us? Or are those things absent from how we present and do our lives? Will we let that vulnerability and that humility move us to pray? Not just about the obvious and the physical and the outward things that catch our eyes so easily, but will we pray for the spiritual battle that we are in, we've seen for the past several weeks, every single day? In that prayer, will we pray for utterance from God in the circles of influence where we find ourselves every single day? Will we ask God for the direct work of the Holy Spirit through us? And will we pray for boldness that we might make known the mystery of the gospel fearlessly, as we should? Folks, Paul is definitely not a superhero. If Paul were a superhero, we would not be able to relate to him. So that's not who Paul is. Paul is someone who is just like you and me, and he's given to us here at the end of Ephesians 6 as an example for us to follow. But to go back to the whole superhero motif, those of you who are Spider-Man fans, you know that in every origin story of Spider-Man, whether it's in comics, movies, or books, whatever, there's always some iteration of the same phrase, right? With great power comes great responsibility, right? We've just spent 7 months unpacking Ephesians and seeing the resources and the blessings and the power that are ours in Jesus Christ. And folks, with that comes great responsibility. And it is the responsibility that we see Paul asking the church at Ephesus to pray for him for. So to kind of make that simple for us today, I'm going to put this on the screen. In these words, Holy Spirit, come and give me words. Holy Spirit, come and give me boldness. Holy Spirit, come and give me the opportunity to speak for the glory of God. Would you just bow your heads this morning? I'm just going to ask you if you would to bow your heads, and I just want to pause here for a second, because we need to process what God has been speaking to us, not just this morning, but throughout the past 7 months of Ephesians. And so you can do that right where you are in prayer in your pew. You can get up and go to the sides and pray at the benches or with the men that are there to counsel if you'd like. Or you can do it by joining in the lyrics of this worship and song. But after all that God has been doing and been saying, we need to respond today. So Father God, we just come to you right now in just simplicity and humility, trying to make ourselves vulnerable to the reality of our dependence and our need for you. And asking you that in this moment, Holy Spirit, that you would come and bring encouragement and bring conviction and bring confession and bring repentance and bring hope and bring power and bring joy and bring strength and bring all that you are because of all that is ours in Jesus Christ. God, help us respond to what you are saying. real quick. Let me just ask you, who was Paul to the church at Ephesus initially? He was their pastor. I told you I'd come back to this. What we see at the end of Ephesians 6 is a pastor begging his church to pray for him. Charles Spurgeon was probably the most effective preacher in the Western world in Victorian England. Those who came to hear him preach, members of parliament that came to hear him preach, the royal family that came to hear him preach. And he was asked one time, Charles, how do you explain, how do you give an account for the incredible influence of your ministry? And he answered with one phrase. He said, my people pray for me. We are all responsible for the survival of the church of God in our current culture. We all individually need to ask God to give us utterance and to give us boldness that we might speak his truth and proclaim Jesus with love wherever we are. But if I can ask you to take one more thing from the end of our study of Ephesians, it is this. And it's the last thing in your notes. Will you pray for your pastor? Will you pray for Pastor Craig? Pray for all of our overseers. But pray for Pastor Craig as he gets up to speak and deliver God's word every Sunday to us.